Once upon a time, of all the good days in the year, on Christmas Eve.
Thank you. fell upon his knees and clasped his hands before his face. "Mercy," he said, "dreadful apparition, why do you trouble me? I wear the chain I forged in life," replied the ghost. "I made it link by link and yard by yard. I girded it on of my own free will, and of my own free will I wore it. At this time of the rolling year, I suffer most. Why did I walk through crowds of fellow beings with my eyes turned down?" "Hear me," cried the ghost. "I am here tonight to warn you that you have yet a chance and hope of escaping my fate. You will be haunted by three spirits. Without their visits, you cannot hope to shun the path I tread. Expect the first tomorrow, when the bell tolls one. Expect the second on the next night at the same hour. The third upon the next night, when the last stroke of 12 has ceased to vibrate. Look to see me no more. And look that, for your own sake, you remember what has passed between us."
No. Stop, spirit, enough. Why do you torture me? The wars of the past have nothing to do with me.
Awaking in the middle of a prodigiously tough snore, Scrooge felt that he was restored to consciousness in the right nick of time. He got up softly and shuffled in his slippers to the door. The moment Scrooge's hand was on the lock, a strange voice called him by his name and bade him enter. He obeyed. It was his own room. But it had undergone a surprising transformation. In easy state upon the couch, there sat a jolly giant. The ghost of Christmas present rose. Spirit, said Scrooge submissively, conduct me where you will. Touch my robe. Scrooge did as he was told and held it fast. Holly, mistletoe, red berries, ivy, turkeys, geese, game, poultry, brawn, meat, pigs, sausages, oysters, pies, puddings, fruit, and punch, all vanished instantly. So did the room, the fire, the ruddy glow, the hour of night, and they stood in the city streets on Christmas morning.
The phantom slowly, gravely, silently approached. When it came, Scrooge bent down upon his knee, for in the very air through which this spirit moved, it seemed to scatter gloom and mystery. "I am in the presence of the ghost of Christmas yet to come," said Scrooge. The spirit answered not, but pointed onward with its hand. "Ghost of the future," he exclaimed, "I fear you more than any spectre I have seen. But as I know your purpose is to do me good, and as I hope to live to be another man from what I was, I am prepared to bear you company, and do it with a thankful heart. Will you not speak to me?" It gave him no reply. The hand was pointed straight before them. "Lead on," said Scrooge, "lead on. The night is waning fast, and it is precious time to me, I know. Lead on, spirit."
Thank you. The spirit stood among the graves and pointed down to one. Scrooge advanced towards it, trembling. The phantom was exactly as it had been, but he dreaded that he saw new meaning in its solemn shape. "Before I draw nearer to that stone to which you point," said Scrooge, "answer me one question. Are these the shadows of the things that will be, or are they the shadow of things that may be only?" Still the ghost pointed downward to the grave by which it stood. "Men's courses will foreshadow certain ends to which, if persevered in, they must lead," said Scrooge. "But if the courses be departed from, the ends will change. Say it is thus with what you show me."
The bed was his own, the room was his own. Best and happiest of all, the time before him was his own to make amends in. "I will live in the past, the present, and the future," Scrooge repeated as he scrambled out of bed. "The spirits of all three shall strive within me." Scrooge was better than his word. He did it all and infinitely more. He became as good a friend and as good a man as the good old city knew. Some people laughed to see the alteration in him, but he let them laugh, and little heeded them, for he was wise enough to know that nothing ever happened on this globe, for good, at which some people did not have their fill of laughter in the outset. And knowing that such as these would be blind anyway, he thought it quite as well that they should wrinkle up their eyes in grins as have the malady in less attractive forms. His own heart laughed, and that was quite enough for him.